Hello everyone. Today we are going to discuss on the topic rehabilitation protocol following arthroscopic repair after rotator cuff injury. The rehabilitation protocol for the patients will vary depending on the type of the tear and the size of the tear. So the types of rotator cuff tears are partial thickness tear, full thickness tear, acute tear, chronic tear, traumatic tear, and finally degenerative tears. Next, we need to understand tear sizes. Okay, so the tear sizes are small, that is 0 to 1 centimeter square. Then we have medium sized tear, that is 1 to 3 centimeter square. Next, large size tear, that is 3 to 5 cm square, and massive size tears, that is more than 5 cm square. So the rehabilitation protocol will vary based on the type of rotator cuff tear and the size of the rotator cuff tear. Now let's begin with the post-operative rehabilitation protocol after partial thickness tear and small size full thickness tears. The rehabilitation protocol will start from phase 1, which is the immediate post-surgical phase. This phase is last from day 0, that is the day of the surgery, till the 4th week post-operative surgery. However, we need to understand that the actual progression should be individualized, that is based on patient to patient, depending on their improvement. So if improvement is visible, only then we progress to the phase 2. Let's understand the goals in this phase. First, maintain or protect the integrity of repair, which we can do by immobilizing the shoulder. Next, progressive increase in the passive range of motion, reducing pain, prevent muscular inhibition, and independence in modified activities of daily living. The precautions that needs to be taken in phase 1 are, for example, lifting of objects and reaching behind the back should not be done. Active range of motion of the shoulder should not be done in this phase. So we'll go for only passive range of motion. Active range of motion are not advised in this phase. A sling should be worn up to 4 to 5 weeks. Okay, all the time, even during sleep, and it should be removed only during exercises. Since it's a small size tear or a partial thickness tear, the sling is used for 4 to 5 weeks. If it's a moderate size tear, we have to go for 6 to 7 weeks even. And finally, the incisions should be kept clean and dry. So from day 1 to 6, as I've already discussed, the sling should be worn all the time and should be removed only during exercise. In terms of exercise, we have to start with passive pendulum exercises, which are also known as Codman's exercises. This should be done 3 times a day. Then in case of active range of motion, we can start only for finger, wrist and elbow, which is also for 3 times a day. Gripping exercises can be given with the help of putty or handball. Next, we can go for active range of motion for the cervical spine as well. Then passive range of motion for the shoulder should be done only in supine position, which comprises of flexion up to 110 degrees, and internal rotation and external rotation only up to 30 degrees. We should also educate the patient regarding posterior joint protection, importance of sling as well as hygiene. Now, to reduce the pain during the exercises, we have to go for cryotherapy. For the first 3 days, we have to go for cryotherapy as much as possible, sometimes about 20 minutes per hour. And if the pain reduces, gradually we need to reduce the amount of cryotherapy, and we can give only when the patient needs it. So from day 7, along with continuation of the previous exercises, we can start increasing the passive range of motion for the shoulder. We can do that by reducing the pain with the help of heat therapy prior to range of motion exercises. Flexion can be increased for more than 110 degrees up to tolerable amount, and internal rotation and external rotation can also be increased for more than 30 degrees. Next, we can begin isometric and isogenic exercises for elbow, hand, forearm, wrist and fingers, as well as for the scapula muscles. To initiate dynamic stabilization, we can go for rhythmic stabilization exercises for the glenohumeral joint in balance position, which is 90 or 100 degrees of elevation. We can also begin rotator cuff isometric exercises in this phase. Next, to improve the general conditioning of the patient, we can advise the patient to go for walking or stationary bicycle exercises, but running and jogging should be avoided. Aquatherapy can be started after 3 weeks postoperatively only if the wounds are healed. So this is the end of phase 1. Next, we'll progress to phase 2. But prior to progression of phase 2, we have to see that the patient has achieved certain goals. So the criteria for progression to phase 2 are as follows. Since in phase 1, we are going for only passive range of motion for the shoulder. So the passive forward flexion should be up to 125 degree or more than 125 degree. Next, passive external rotation in scapular plane should be more than 60 degree, and internal rotation should also be more than or equal to 60 degree. The last one, passive abduction should be more than 90 degrees. So the phase 2 is also known as protection and protected active phase, which is from week 5 up to week 12. This is also known as motion phase, and the goals for this phase are allow healing of soft tissue, do not overstress healing soft tissue, gradually restore full passive range of motion up to 5 weeks, then decrease pain and inflammation. The precautions that needs to be taken during this phase are no lifting activities, no supported full body weight with hands or arms, no sudden jerking motion, no excessive behind back motion, and no bike or upper extremity ergometer exercises until week 6. From week 5 to 6, along with continuation of the periscapular exercises, we have to go for gradual weaning of the sling. We need to see that by the end of week 6, the sling is removed. Prior to this week, active range of motion was not done at all. So we are going to initiate active range of motion, mainly shoulder flexion, only in supine position from this week. So passive range of motion should be continued, and we need to see that by week 6, full passive range of motion is achieved without pain. We can go for pulley exercises in this phase, and if there is any sort of restriction to for achieving active range of motion or passive range of motion, we can also go for glenohumeral as well as scapular joint mobilization. Prone rolling can also be started in this phase, and cryotherapy can be continued only when required or after any exercise session. From week 7 to 9, along with continuation of the previous exercises, we mainly have to go for stretching to achieve full active range of motion. So the main aim in this week is to achieve full active range of motion. We can go for stretching of the internal rotators, shoulder extensors, as well as cross body stretching and sleeper stretch to mobilize the posterior capsule. Seated press ups can be done, and we have to initiate active range of motion exercises for flexion, abduction, external rotation as well as internal rotation, and it should be pain free. While doing the exercises, we need to see that shoulder shrugging is not done. If shrugging is there, we have to limit the range of motion exercises up to 90 degree. We have to correct the shrugging problem, and then we need to go for the further active range of motion exercises. We can also go for strengthening program, a very limited amount of strengthening program, such as for external rotation and internal rotators, we can use exercise bands, sport tubing or adduction pillow. And for external rotators, we can go for isotonic exercises in sideline position with low weight and high repetition. And elbow flexion and extension isotonics can also be done. This is the end of phase 2. We'll progress to phase 3, that is early strengthening phase. which is from week 10 up to week 16. So the criteria for progression to phase 3 from phase 2 is full active range of motion. So we'll see that the patient has achieved at least full active range of motion. A few degrees of less range of motion is fine. The goals for phase 3 are full active range of motion. Next, maintain full passive range of motion. Dynamic shoulder stability for glenohumeral as well as scapulothoracic joint, and gradual restoration of glenohumeral and scapular strength, power and endurance, optimized neuromuscular control, and the last one, gradual return to functional activities. The precautions that needs to be taken in this phase are: no lifting objects for more than 5 pounds, no sudden lifting or pushing activities, and exercise should not be painful. In week 10, along with continuation of the previous exercises, we can start dynamic strengthening exercises. We can begin light isometric exercises in 90 by 90 position. PNF D2 flexion extension patterns can be done against light manual resistance. So we can start scapular plane elevation exercises up to 90 degrees, and if the patient is unable to perform, we can continue the use of cuff as well as scapular exercises. Full can exercises can be done. In this phase, empty can exercise should not be done, and then prone rowing, prone extension as well as prone horizontal abduction exercises should be done. In week 12, we have to continue the previous exercises, that is from week 10, but along with that we need to add light functional activities. We have to also go for low level plyometric exercises such as two-handed or below chest level drills, progressing to overhead and then finally one-handed drills. By week 14, along with continuation from the previous week, that is week 12 to 13, we also have to add fundamental exercises such as bench press and shoulder press, etc. So this is the end of phase 3. We can progress to phase 4 now. So the criteria for progression to phase 4 are: the individual should be able to tolerate at least low level of functional activities, and the person should demonstrate the return of strength to the shoulder muscles and re-establishment of dynamic shoulder stability, and the person should be able to demonstrate adequate amount of strength and dynamic stability for progression to more demanding work and sport-specific activities. Next, we'll progress to phase 4, which is the last phase of this rehabilitation protocol. This phase is known as advanced strengthening phase, and it lasts from week 16 up to week 22. So the goals of this phase are: maintain full non-painful active range of motion. Next, we have advanced conditioning exercises for enhanced functional and sports specific use. Next, improve muscular strength, power and endurance. And the last one, gradual return to all functional activities. In week 16, along with continuation of the previous exercises, we have to go for advanced proprioceptive training and neuromuscular exercises to achieve neuromuscular control. Light isotonic strengthening exercises should also be given in 90 by 90 position, and initiation of light sporting activity should be done. So this is the main thing actually in case of athletes. So suppose a person is a golf player, then we'll go for light activities involving golf, for example golf chipping or putting, or in case of a tennis player, we can go for tennis ground strokes. From week 20 to 22, which is the end of this rehabilitation program, we can continue the strengthening and stretching program, and along with that we can also continue the joint mobilization if the motion is tight. We can initiate sports program here in proper interval, so the athletes can start their particular sport in this week. So this is the end of the rehabilitation protocol for partial tear or small size full thickness tear in case of rotator cuff injury. Thank you everyone.